So this leads you in the direction of trying to come up with alternative ways of setting up the problem in order to get a better look at it. And I argue, makes clear that even though the Atlantic slave trade was a very peculiar sort of migration, it's a migration, it's governed by the same principles as other migrations. You use the same variables, the values given to those variables are somewhat different. So, just to anticipate some of the points I get to if I don't run out of time, this is setting things up in this way is an example of a world historical methodology, of setting up a problem, defining an approach to it, thinking of past a stage of sort of brainstorming to formal modeling, analyzing things within that model, and then stepping back and looking at it and asking, is there a better way of addressing this problem? So I'm going to look at three types of modeling, three formulations of the same issue. So here's step one, just defining the roles involved in the slave trade. So I have assumed a free population in Africa divided into, and I divided them neatly into those who do the enslavement and those who suffer losses to enslavement. So we're already to assumptions that were violated by actual reality, right? Because people were grabbing each other back and forth, and but I just haven't come up with an easy way to model that. But nonetheless, the one thing that's come out of this modeling that really is a helpful way of thinking about things is that people are taken from the status of free person and made a captive and kept a captive for a while before they become a slave. So someone who's been removed from the position of freedom and is being moved from one place to another has really high rates of mortality and social disorientation during this time. Leading up to the time when those who make it through are socialized and renamed and put into a position as slavery, which they at some level accept. Okay, but then there's the captives on the African continent, and of them, some go outside to the Atlantic world, some go outside to what I call the Orient at that point, or more likely just called the Old World at that point, and some of them go into slavery on the African continent. Right? And some of the slave people become free after a while. So that's the very general statement of the model. And then here is specifying in a little more detail all the actual movements from that source population up there. Those are the free people who lose people to enslavement. The captors population, they're the ones who just collect slaves and in a word, benefit from it. Okay, and then I'm not going to trace all of these things, but there are the steps of the reproduction of this system, and it certainly shows that the size and shape of slave populations in the Americas are dependent on the size and shape of the populations in Africa from which they've come, and vice versa. So then I took those relationships and put them in the form of linear equations, and so this is just a very conceptual statement of the main equations. They're just regular demographic equations for the reproduction and updating of a population. So I've got this initial population, the source population. You begin with their population in the previous period. You add the births during that period, the deaths are subtracted. Then they lose people to capture, and then you also want to make sure that you keep account of those who die in the course of capture, who don't ever get to the point of being the captives. Right, and then here's another identity, the captives, all the people who go in any five-year period to this category of captive become those who are captives in Africa, those who are captives abroad, and then those who are lost in transit are subtracted out. Here's a captor population which just grows in this case, and then the populations of slaves in Africa where you have those who are already slaves in Africa and then new folks added in, and then the regular steps of birth and death for each of those. Okay, so that's the way I initially did the work, and one version of this appeared in my 1990 book on slavery and African life. And here's a way of stating the organization, the strategy of the research, okay? You come up with this historical data on the Atlantic slave trade. Those are things we can go look up someplace. But then we have estimated data on African population size. So that's a I'll actually spend a lot of time for the rest of today talking about that part of figuring out what I thought the population of the different regions of Africa were in the mid-19th century when the slave trade is beginning to die out. One of the hard parts of this is that the African slave trade does not just die out neatly in 1807 or 1808 or something like that, but continues to send large numbers of people out of the continent or from one part of the continent to another right up to the beginning of the 20th century. But in any case, that's data manipulation. And then in some cases, you just have to assume data, all right? So demographic patterns are fairly well known. It's known that there are certain limits of birth rates can't exceed a certain amount. And the variation between women's rates of birth when they're between 15 and 19, which is sort of a low point, and between 25 and 29, which is sort of a high point, these show up dependably in every population. So I can project that to African populations. I can project the relationship of death rates amongst the different age groups to African populations, even without data, with some relative security. There's still the question of what was the expectation of life of African populations. And in my initial work, I assumed it was something like 27 and a half years for the 18th century during the height of the slave trade. And I've since learned that that's just way too high. The comparative evidence for the rest of the world and such evidence, as direct evidence as we have for Africa, makes it much closer to something like 22 or 23 years, which is low, but I mean, that's what it was. Okay, so those are the input data, and then out of that, we calculate some results. And the particular results I'm concerned with is what was the growth rate of the African population in any region and time, and also what was the sex ratio